Now, moving forward, if we look at earned value method, it's really quite comprehensive, quite popular, and very powerful because we are able to monitor based on the amount of work which has actually been performed. Okay, it's not based on money spent or man hours spent or anything which is more subjective. It is on what is actually done, and it is able to integrate the cost and schedule and the work scope. Okay, so this is the key part why earned value management, because they say it's cost, time, and work scope integration is brought into a metric which can give you an idea of how the project is performing. So if we go into just review the terminology, okay, we can look at budgeted cost of work schedule. We have discussed this. I'm just reviewing it because it's important to have a slightly formal coverage of these from a definition and a formula perspective. Basically, we know it tells the budgeted cost. Okay, it is how much work is scheduled to be completed in each period based on value metric, money in our example. Okay, and this is the S curve. Now, budgeted cost of work performed, this is the earned value. And we can obtain this by getting unit rate into quantity of work performed. This is how we did the calculation. But you'll realize that I can also do this by percentage complete into budgeted cost of work scheduled. Will also give me the earned value of the project at that update. Actual cost of work performed, we can do this by getting the value from the accounts and actually what is maintained in terms of actual cash spent. Now, based on these two, we get the schedule and cost variance. Okay, so these are the project performance indicators. I can do BCWP minus BCWS to get my schedule variance. And as you can see here, if the schedule variance value is less than zero, it's behind schedule; more than zero, ahead of schedule; if it's equal to zero, the project is on schedule. Okay, so this becomes an indicator for variance of the project. Similarly, my cost variance is budgeted cost of work performed minus actual cost of work performed. Okay, so we had seen how what is the value you got of work you actually did for the money you spent. So this is what gives you cost variance. Again, less than zero, it's over budget; greater than zero, it's under budget; equal to zero, it's on budget. Okay, now another way of looking at the performance is what we call SPI, Schedule Performance Index, or the Cost Performance Index. So here it's a ratio. Okay, we had dealt with this ratio initially. We looked at it intuitively. Okay, for the earthwork example, we remember we got values of 0.4. We dealt with it intuitively, but we could see that this ratio, if it is less than 1, it's behind schedule. Okay, greater than 1, ahead of schedule; and equal to 1, the project is on schedule. So these become, when management looks at it, they will ask you for the SPI, they'll ask you for CPI, and then say, based on that, they can judge where the project is at that stage of the monitoring phase. Similarly, CPI, okay, you have a ratio and the similar range for CPI. Now, one more critical parameter that is used in basic earned value is forecasting. Okay, I should be able to use my performance measures to be able to forecast where am I going to finish. So your CPI, okay, gives me my cost performance index. I take my budget at completion, BAC, divide by CPI, and I get my revised project completion budget. Okay, now this is just one of the equations or one of the formulations for estimated completion, but please realize, okay, there are references which give us, there are several alternate computations for this based on the assumptions made. So here we are extrapolating based on current CPI, but certainly we know in a project the things can change. So might be the current cost performance is not going to be what is going to be in the future, in which case the estimated completion it's a dynamic aspect which will keep changing. This is just one basic way of computing it. And most people recommend, if you want to complete schedule at completion, go back to the network, update the network, and based on the network, do schedule at completion, estimate of schedule at completion. And although the earned value terminology gives you an equivalent equation for schedule at completion, it is recommended that we go back to the CPM network and update the network to be able to find the schedule at completion. Now, just going back to our example here, so we looked at, now that we have reviewed the terminology, we can see, you know, the budgeted cost of work performed, we looked at the budgeted cost of work scheduled, actual cost of work performed, we looked at our scheduled performance, cost performance, and in both cases, we said that, you know, we should have been at 76.8, but we are only at 70.6 as far as schedule goes, so we are behind schedule. And although we spent 74.1, we only got 70.6 worth of work, so we are over budget. Now, if we look, one thing is when we go to the work package level, okay, we can also do a comparison at the work package level and see what are the packages which are affecting. So this gave us a project snapshot. So if I go to the work package level, you can see that at earthwork, okay, we had scheduled only 2, but 2.5. That means my earthwork is doing better than what was planned or scheduled. Okay. Whereas in my concreting, I can see that 25.2 was what was scheduled. I'm only at 16.8. I'm way behind schedule as far as concreting goes. Okay. As far as formwork or reinforcement, okay, both of these, I'm on what I had originally plan to do. You can see 12.6, 12.6, 33.6, it's a plan. And as far as brickwork also, I'm ahead. So while I'm ahead on brickwork, earthwork, and I'm, you know, okay, I'm doing as planned on formwork and reinforcement, I'm really behind on my concreting. So this allows me to actually pinpoint that concreting package is what is causing me to fall behind schedule. And in this case, we have no values for plastering because plastering is not yet started. As we get further into the update cycle on this project, you can see from the bar chart that plastering will start at a later stage. And as we keep updating on each of those phases, certainly plastering and other values will start coming in. We can do a similar comparison with the value of work performed versus actual cost and see where our variances are occurring. And you will find in this particular case, the brickwork, we have actually done more, got more value than what we spent, but in almost all the other cases, we have actually spent, you know, marginally more than the value of work done. So again, we might want to look at, and you know, at a package level and analyze why this is happening and take control actions for this. So we can see that one value, like we had discussed earlier, gives us an insight into the project, both at the project level and at the work package level. And as we can go into the work package, into more details into the work package and the work breakdown structure, might be we will be able to get it down to activity level, in which case I don't need to use earned value. I can use my direct monitoring approach of quantity versus total quantity and productivity and things like this. So successfully to be able to monitor a project requires coordination at all these levels, you know, at the work phase level, you know, at the site office, at the planning office, at the management. So, you know, I hope you have a feel of how earned value gives you more the higher and the package level issues, while the productivity monitoring and the detail issues we covered in the last session give you at the execution level of, more at the execution and the planning to execution level. Okay, now, again, so here we have, you know, all of the terminology we've discussed in a more comprehensive graph. So again, here we have the green. Okay, you know, okay, green is the actual cost of work performed. Okay, that's green. And the red graph is the budgeted cost of work scheduled. Okay, budgeted cost of work scheduled. This is as per plan. Okay, and the green of actual cost of work performed is the money that we spent. Okay, the purple budgeted cost of work performed is the earned value. Okay, this is the budgeted cost of work performed, and this is the data, the monitoring time we have taken, and in this monitoring time we got the earned value, ACWP, and we had already had BCWS, and we were able to calculate the variances. And when we forecast from this, you know, we looked at how a basic way of estimated completion. Okay, and the budgeted completion here you can see is what we had originally budgeted, and we looked at how estimated completion can be obtained, and based on this you can actually calculate the variance of the total project cost at completion. So almost all the terminology we have discussed is shown in this figure, And you know, we can look at, so here we have the variances, you know, the schedule variance, the cost variance, you know, and based on these two, we have the schedule performance index or the cost performance index. So this slide in a way summarizes a lot of what all the parameters of earned value and what they mean in a graphical sense and how they are kind of used and applied to be able to monitor a project. Now, sometimes when we would like to look at earned value in a stepwise way, okay, so I hope the concepts on which it is based is clear. Now, we would always like to make it a kind of a procedure. So if we are going to look at it in a stepwise fashion, the first thing to do is to calculate the budgeted cost of work schedule for each period. Okay, so you remember from our bar chart, we were able to take a month-wise, you know, we were able to find all the cost, the planned cost at each month and be able to plot the S-curve as well as the monthly expenditure, which is the budgeted cost of work schedule. Then for each update period, we actually calculate budgeted cost of work performed. Okay, and we calculate budget cost of work performed by taking field measurement of work performed and multiplying it by the unit rate for that measurement. That would be the ideal way to do it. But in cases where that cannot be done, it might be through an estimate of percentage complete. And we looked at some of these from the lecture last time, you know. So ultimately, either I can get to a percentage complete by an estimate or percentage complete by actually measuring the work performed and dividing by the total work at the activity level. This is at the activity level. Then at the same update period, I can find actual cost of work performed, okay, based on my accounts. And these then give me my basic parameters for my earned value analysis. So I can compare my budgeted cost of work performed with budgeted cost of work scheduled and actual cost of work performed to determine the project performance indicators and the percentage complete of the project. Now, then we can also do this forecasting for estimated completion, and based on these parameters, I can take control actions as required. And like we just saw, this need not be only at the project level. We can come down to drill down to the work package level or at a further detail level, where there are multiple activities, to be able to apply the earned value concept to be able to monitor and take control actions required at different levels of the project. Now, I'd like to end kind of showing or, you know, to make you think about this. When I look at earned value and I look at all of the S-curve and the, you know, BCWP and the ACWP and all of this, I'm always reminded of a limited over game, and we can see the run rate, the asking rate, the catch-up rate, you know, the wickets taken. So, I mean, I leave it to the course participants to think about this and see, you know, is there any correlation we have between how we do a run chase, you know, for, you know, given an asking rate is given, might be you know, a budgeted cost of work schedule is what the first team has given and the second team is actually doing the execution. So, you know, if you have analogies on this, it'll be interesting to hear about it, okay? Now, to summarize what we have covered, basically earned value approach is a comprehensive approach for monitoring project at a macro level. I think through the concepts covered this, I hope you get the feel of how you can really go to the project level and be able to calculate percentage complete, schedule performance and cost performance, okay? And that is really the main, you know, USP of the earned value approach. And it is doing this based on the actual work done. That is core. It's not based on, you know, money spent or things like that. In this lecture, we used money as a metric for earned value. Okay, we used money, and the earned value unit of earned value is the money unit. Now, in many places, man hours is used. Okay, the reason man hours is used is because man hours tends to be, you know, the major component of cost in many global projects. Okay, you know, if you control man hours, you control the project and you control the money that is spent on the project. So by controlling man hours, people find in many places that you are not only controlling money, but you're controlling also the schedule better with the man hour metric than the money metric. So in many global projects, man hour is the base for your earned value metric. But most projects in India have seen are using money, because we have always kept more, you know, from the early years, we have kept track of money more than man hours, because our labor is considered to be cheap and we might not pay by man hours, etc. But please realize that both can be done, and it's really, today with increasing costs in labor, etc., man hours is becoming important. Okay, man hours is becoming more important, I would say, and it's already important, and we should also be able to do based on a man hour metric. Now, one of the interesting aspects is if I measure progress based on money or metric or man hour metric, I can get different results. So this is interesting. I don't have the time to be able to illustrate that, but might be those of you who are interested can explore this further. So I could get a percentage complete on a project which says 40% based on money and 60% based on man hours. So this is one of the subjective elements, and a good planning team should have a judgment on what is really the appropriate metric for their kind of work and their kind of project. Now, also, while EVA is a good comprehensive technique, the accuracy of results is based on the measurement of work performed. If I don't get my measurement of work performed correctly, obviously the project parameters will not indicate things right. And we discussed in the last lecture how sometimes this measurement is not as objective as we would like it to be. There are subjective elements. I know there can be estimates, there can be variations, and we should also factor this into when we take the values based on earned value, that the level at which we are measurement should be accurate. Now, one thing that's happening in this front is that more and more of automated measurement is taking place. People don't have to fill forms, but you can actually go to the site with a smartphone or a tablet, enter values in it, which is then uploaded to the server, and there is less chance for errors. Or even more advanced are techniques where you have image processing or other techniques which actually capture your progress as you do and automatically updates. These are more research areas, but they are getting there, and we expect that some of these values are more accurate when such technology is used. And finally, in this, earned value is a very, very broad area. There's a lot of terminology. If you go to some of the sites, especially with the US government where they use earned value management, there are manuals which run into hundreds of pages which just talk about the terminology and the calculations based on earned value. In this lecture, we have only covered very basic elements just to give you an introduction to earned value for you to understand that these concepts exist. And as a professional, you might have to use these concepts at a later stage. I think we have laid the foundation for these concepts, and you should be able to use it and work out basic examples and get comfortable with the terminology at this stage. So I look forward to questions and discussions on this topic. Thank you.